today in Chandigarh on the invitation of the Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi, which is celebrating Amrita Sher-Gil's birth anniversary. We have Sudarshan Shetty, India's most well-known and renowned installation and sculptural artist, known for his enigmatic sculptures and installations. Shetty ji is here to discuss his work, the process of his creative journey, as well as screen a film, a song, a story for Chandigarh art lovers. Here we will have a brief introduction with Shetty ji on his work and of course the Biennale.
Thank you, Parul.
Welcome to Punjab Lalit Kala Akademi. So you have been coming to Chandigarh off and on for artistic practices. So tell us a little about today's screening of the film and a little about the film first.
Yeah, I mean, it's an honor to be here on such an occasion and on Amrita Sher-Gil's birthday. I'm screening a film that was made, I mean, this is a work that I made very, very recently. It was shown in Bombay as the first showing, which is a very, very kind of limited showing, and I hope to show it more in the coming days elsewhere. So this was based upon a folk story that comes from Karnataka and as told by A.K. Ramanujam.
Okay.
When I was a student, and you know, this was a black and white era when, you know, I still remember Ramanujam narrating this story. Which remained with me for a long time. And this is a story about a woman who has a story to tell and a song to sing. And she never does tell the story, or neither does she sing the song.
Okay.
So the song and the story inside her decide to teach her a lesson. So while she's asleep, waiting for her husband to return home in the evening, the song and the story come out of her breath, ride on her breath and come out into the world. And the song becomes a man's umbrella, and the story becomes a pair of man's shoes. And when the husband comes back home, he looks at this, he wakes up his wife and he's suspicious, and he says, who's been here? And you know, she's not aware of anything, and they have an argument, and he kind of leaves the house and he goes to the House of Lights and lays down there. So the House of Lights is where all the lights of the village come and gather, and they chat, having been put off after their day's work from their respective homes. So the light from his house comes late, and all the other lights ask, what happened, why are you late? So the light narrates the story of what happened, and the husband, who is overhearing all these conversations, realizes his mistake, and he runs back home, and he wakes up his wife and asks, why did you not tell me that you had a story to tell and a song to sing? And she says, what story, what song? She has lost both the story and the song. So this is something that remained with me. I think, you know, it was also to do with the fact that, you know, what does it mean to, you know, as an artist for me, my role as a sculptor or an installation artist or whatever that may be, for me to produce objects, and what is the compulsion that you must tell your stories as much as it is for everyone else, is something that kind of interested me. And you know, like years later now, you know, like after having heard the story maybe 30 years ago,
yes,
I think it was important for me to kind of play it out in a manner that I could.
Yes.
So this what we did was, I constructed two sculptural objects.
Okay.
One is a home, private home.
Okay.
One, the other is a public space, which is the House of Lights.
Okay.
And the story kind of unfolds between these two spaces.
Right.
And we took it to two different locations.
Okay.
And shot the same.
In different locations.
Yeah.
Okay.
And shot the same story twice.
Okay.
So what you'll see is, I mean, it's basically a two-way projection,
right?
Two-channel projection, you see both these stories unfold with slight variations in each of the screens, it was shown with these two structures
okay.
that were made as a set for the film. So you'll possibly see the structures first and then see the film, and when you come back, you see the structures perhaps in a different way.
Exactly.
So, or you could become part of the structures, part of the story yourself.
Yes.
So that was the basic premises from where we started, and yeah, it was very exciting making these films, and yeah, and I'm like looking forward to share it with the audience.
Oh, yeah. It's a unique experience, absolutely. Is it something very new that is something very new for you also? The filmmaking, architecture has been a part of your art practice. I mean, you take inspiration. But was the experience this time something very different from what you've done before?
Yeah.
In terms of the film?
No, I've made other films earlier.
Yes.
I mean, this is my third, you know, live action film in terms of shooting people live. I've made other films which are digital in nature, with my work. And this intersection of, you know, what does it mean to build, the idea of making and dissemination is something that interests me in my own work. So if I were to put out objects in the world, you know, how does it get read? Or what does it mean for me to, you know, put out more objects in addition to all the objects that we already have in various images? What does it mean is something that has been of a primary concern for a long time. So I think, you know, in that sense, you know, when you see these objects as something that is made as a set which is eminently dismantleable, is something that interests me, that, you know, you make something of a monument or a kind of something that looks permanent, but is then, you know, when you watch the film, you know that, you know, it's like made for the film, and it's eminently dismantleable. You know, what is the value of set, and how it gets disseminated in terms of image making vis-a-vis making of film.
Absolutely.
So it's something that interests me. So I think, you know, this kind of back and forth between what is real and what may be read as unreal, in that sense, is something that gets played out between the objects and the film in this case.
Right. So we started with the film, but let's start with you now.
Yeah.
Tell us a little of your journey. You are probably India's first new media artist who moved from painting to installation and sculpture. Hardly did much painting, but it was your fascination with installations. Yeah. And at that time, back in time, there was not much of this practice which was prevalent in India. So where did your inspiration, your father being in the arts and theater and music, and your house being filled with artistic innovations, did it somewhere play on your personality, and how did it all happen?
I'm sure. I mean, it's largely osmotic, because I like you said, you know, I grew up with a lot of storytelling and music, and I happened to be good at drawing and painting when I was in the school, and you know, that led me to, you know, to go to an art school, that everyone around me believed that I could be an artist, so I did, you know. so I went to an art school, and once I went to an art school, you know, I was like exposed to this huge art world, which was out there, you know, and a lot of our education was about things, or, you know, we were like really eager to know what was going on in the West,
right?
And where does this art education come from? And I went to a school that was set up by British almost 200 years ago. And there was a lot of stress on portrait painting, which was British, came from British portrait painting tradition, which was set up by the British. Also got mixed up with the Bauhaus curriculum, which obviously got introduced at some point in time. So coming out of the art school, also I started looking at, there was this huge gap between, say, inside a gallery or a museum space or outside of it. So one of my thing was to kind of, you know, bring that, you know, what are those points of mediation after having come from a certain kind of education that is dictated by Western canons.
Yes.
How do you bring them together from where I come from? Because, for example, you know, when I went to an art school, I began making these strange pictures, and my parents were a little worried for a while because they thought that I was going astray because I could paint Amitabh Bachchan portrait very well at a certain point of time before I went to the art school. So I think, you know, I just kind of consciously, you know, started thinking about, you know, where we came from and how it could be at loggerheads at times with how we were learned, we were taught to make art.
Right.
So I think these are the questions I'm still grappling with, and I don't have definitive answers for it. You know, like, I mean, when I say that, you know, where we come from, I don't have a definitive answer for that as well. It's not like a kind of very defined mass that I can draw from. When we talk about tradition, it's also something of a, I mean, it's so vast at the same time. It's also, it can be particular and vast at the same time. So when we say tradition, does it mean yesterday or 10,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or 200 years ago? You know, it's... And also ways of looking at tradition has to be kind of, I thought, you know, kind of explored.
Okay.
And in a way that it cannot be seen as something that is from the past, as like a, you know, definitive mass from
That's
the past.
Right.
It is something that part of our how far it is a part of our contemporary lives.
Exactly.
And how important for us to look back, to be able to look forward, is something that I've been looking at. So I draw these kind of ideas from what is available for me, you know, in various different ways. So it could be, you know, poetry that was written between 12th and the 15th century, the Nirgun poetry that I've been interested in, or it could be, you know, for example, where I came from, you know, naturally, my father's art. So I see a lot of resonances between a lot of things that are termed as traditional, you know. There is a lot of aesthetic choices, aesthetic strategies that could be borrowed from there.
Right.
Which is what I try to do in my own work.
And it's a conscious effort? No, it comes naturally.
It is also a conscious effort to be able to kind of, I think, you know, like I said, you know, like you, it could be seen in loggerheads, you know, like the expectation of a contemporary art space and where you come from, so to say, generally speaking. So I think, you know, how do you kind of find those mediating positions or, you know, points of mediations is something that I'm looking at in own work.
But was it tough at that time, Sudarshan, to deviate from the, as you say, a normal or conventional course of art in and then move to something which wasn't very prevalent or practiced?
Mm-hmm.
Were there apprehensions? Were there roadblocks? Were there, in terms of even selling? Because
I think
More challenges that you face because you decided to step out of that comfort zone?
I think, you know, I think my comfort zone also lies in the fact that, you know, I come from a household where a lot of storytelling and, you know, music, I mean, I'm naturally attracted to, say, you know, Hindustani classical music. I listen to a lot of artists, you know, including Kumar Gandharva. So I think my comfort zone also lies there more than that.
Right.
So I think, you know, it's a way of kind of finding these ways to kind of, you know, bring that in into a space with a completely that comes with another kind of expectation.
Okay.
And take those conditions that this contemporary art space comes with, whatever they may be, out into the world out there in some ways. So it's like a both ways of conversation, that it's bringing them in and taking it out from those expectations. So I think, you know, there has to be a case made for how, not really, you know, like I think there is a prerequisite that, you know, it must come from your own locality.
Right.
By saying locality, I don't mean a geographical locality.
I know.
It's much larger than that.
Right.
That it must come from your own locality. That's a prerequisite. And when you were to come from, like really come from there, and it's a very challenging position, that you have to kind of, you know, meet with the conditions, certain conditions that a contemporary art space comes with.
Yes.
So how do we deal with that? Is something of a, yeah, there is a case to be made for that. Yeah.
So tell us a little about your earlier works and what were the challenges that you face. And you've always worked with objects, objects which have, they may be different objects, but they have different histories, they have different cultural contexts, and then you bring them together with mechanics and fluids, and it's gorgeous, and there's always a narrative and context. So a little about your work when you decided that, okay, this installations is what I'm going to do, sculpture is what will be a integral part of it. Something that will give us a little view of how you thought as an artist.
Yeah, I mean, I went and, you know, like enrolled myself at the JJ School of Art and studied, I mean, I was a student of painting. And over the period of time in the school that we were exposed to so much of, you know, what was happening in the West, and, you know, and slowly I realized that, you know, there was this kind of possibility to move into making objects that I wanted to get into. So after my studies in painting got over, in 85 I went to 87 I went to Ahmedabad to kind of to be able to make sculptures and, you know, study the conventional techniques of how to make a mold or how to make, you know, objects. So it was only to do with you know, like, so I started making a lot of objects that were like, you know, replicas of, so I was like, you know, interested in the idea of semantics, how kind of things change when it is cast, and, you know, what are the differences, or what are the kind of, what is the evolution that happens, or what are the conversations between the real and the, you know, objectified sculpture, you know, when you make a sculpture, how does it kind of read differently than from the source that it comes from.
True.
So I think, you know, that kind of led me to kind of think about, you know, what does it mean to kind of add objects into this world, like, you know, to repeat myself from where I began, that how does making and dissemination of it, what is the important, like, you know, do you need to, you know, make more, add more objects into it. And in that sense, you know, like making objects or gathering objects around ourselves in terms, in some ways, points at our own mortality in many ways. Like you build monuments for the dead, and it's like a way of extending your own life beyond your biological existence.
True.
So I think these questions became more and more apparent, that that my making of the object, but I had no choice than to make these objects. So, but the question was, can I include the idea that it could be meaningless, this act in itself could be meaningless, into the same space of experience of making it. So I think, you know, that has been like a leitmotif for me for a long time, right now. So when you look at my work, it all, in some way or the other, having spent so much of time and energy in making it, in some way or the other, it points at its own collapse, under its own, the collapse under its own, you know, spectacle, so to say.
Yes, but I look at
can
your
those
work.
Both, can those, both those positions can be inclusive within the same space of experience.
Okay, so if they can coexist.
Yes.
Okay. And, but I also, when I look at your work, the little that I have, There's a life in all, in those objects, which is beautiful, and how you infuse that with your own creations of dance, music, theatre, that's most amazing and fascinating. So tell me, is there any particular work or works that are very close to your heart for any reasons that you would like to talk about, especially in the earlier practice when you began, because it was an unconventional time to do it?
I think, you know, I'm not, you know, one of the things that I don't feel so attached to things that are like already made, that I'm already on to, you know, something else after having, you know, something has been made. So I find it very, very difficult at times to talk about my work that was made 10 years ago, because I'm, I'm, you know, I've moved 10 years away from it, right? So I think, you know, I mean, in that sense, you know, all the work that I make become a part of a larger kind of process.
Right.
It's not, I mean, I don't see my work in postulations in that sense.
It's,
it's a part of a larger process somewhere that I must find and I must kind of identify as I move or as I evolve as an artist or as a human being, you know, being engaged with it in various ways.
So as an artist, for someone who's not, how does it work? Does an idea take some time to form, and then what is the process that takes you to the ultimate journey? And also, does it change sometimes in between, that you had thought of this and then when you began working on it, it turned out to be something completely that surprised you as well?
Yeah, I think, you know, all these ideas are to be treated as something that drives you to kind of make something, you know, like in terms of objects, like, you know, you may get an idea in the morning that you would like to make this. But I think in the process of how it kind of evolves through the time of its own making is something that excites me enormously, more than the idea.
That's right.
The idea becomes like a backdrop or a kind of a pivot from where you move in various ways. That work or an object that you're making may have its own life, so that that space that you allow for itself to move in different ways is very important for me.
Right. And as an artist and as now as a curator also, how has this process juxtaposed in terms of curation and your own work? Has there been in this last 1.5-2 years a change in your own practice with this?
I think, yeah, when I get back to it, I mean, every, like, you know, this has been an enormous opportunity to be able to kind of be inside people's studios, inside people's heads in various ways. And I remember every kind of, in many instances where, you know, where I come out of a studio, I mean, there's a condition that, you know, as an artist, I could not but reflect back upon my own work. So it was a way of, you know, opening up my limitations and actually kind of finding those limitations within my work, identifying those limitations. And in that sense, it will have some kind of resonance in what I'll make in the future, for sure.
Okay. So tell us a little about, you just briefly mentioned classical music and Nirgun poetry. So how does that translate into your work, in your own practice of work? As well as stories.
Yeah. So one of the first challenges was, you know, how do you kind of bring in these ideas into, is there a way to do it? You know, like I've been talking about, you know, I've been using the word mediation a lot.
Yes.
So, you know, for want of a better word, it's much more complex than that, so to say, that it's not like, you know, there's a certain kind of, you know, defined structure of an art education that I received. Neither is a defined structure of a tradition of, or, you know, as I keep saying, you know, where I come from. So it's a very, very kind of amorphous spaces that you're kind of constantly kind of going back and forth with. I think, you know, it's like, simply put, you know, that, you know, like, how do you bring in a life that is outside of a gallery or a museum space that seems so diverse and so removed from each other, is something that I've been looking to kind of work towards. So talking about Nirgun poetry, I mean, Nirgun poetry was introduced to me by through music of Kumar Gandharvas, which I heard as a student, and you know, it remained with me, and I got more and more interested in this different sound that he kind of be able to kind of different way of looking at music, or through that different way of looking at the world. That interested me a lot. You know, that worldview kind of, you know, remained with me, and it became emblematic of a lot of the things that I had come or come to have experienced as a child with my father's art and the other arts I got interested in later that are termed as traditional, whatever it means, because I mean, for me, it is eminently contemporary, a lot of them, whether it's Hindustani classical musicians that I've been very, very interested in. So, for example, you know, going to Nirgun poetry, like, you know, one of the works that I made was Shoonya Ghar.
Hanji.
So there's this poetry written by Gorakhnath, which was written in 12th century AD. And you know, I got introduced to it by Kumar Gandharva's music, and you know, I got more interested. And it's based upon this poetry which goes, Shunya ghar shahar, shahar ghar basti, kaun sota, kaun jaage hai. Loosely translated, empty is this house, empty is this city, empty is this fort, empty is, it's empty everywhere. And the second line says, who's asleep and who's awake? If everything is empty, which is established in the first line, then where is the question of, you know, anyone being asleep or awake? So there's very often that, often than not, the first line establishes this image. And the second line comes up with a diverse image, not necessarily a counter image, but completely diverse image. They're seemingly kind of unrelated, but it does create a kind of enormous cosmotic space. And it's no more about the words alone. It's also about what it creates, what, you know, it's in between these two lines, so to say. So I think, you know, I got interested in that. There is a certain aesthetic strategy that it kind of comes with. Like, for example, Kabir says that lagan bina jagena nirmohi. So he says, until you have an intense devotion to something, you will not invoke the detached within yourself. So there is there is devotion and detachment in the same line, as if they were not two different things. So this is something that interests me a lot. So I try to use those strategies, if they were strategies, in a much more open-ended way. That can we kind of, you know, kind bring that into a space where it seems that at times at loggerheads, that, you know, you don't see things in binaries, that it, like, you know, you see things in everything in a singular flow, even if they were to be separated and seen as opposites, they are not in opposition within that same space of experience.
Sudarshan, if you could talk a little about the recent works, apart, of course, from this film that you have done, and also correlate them to moving away from conventional gallery spaces and moving to new audiences also, which I feel personally new media art has been able to do. So a few works that were consciously probably done, or no, something that you feel the reach was much more like the winged bus work, which I thought was very fascinating, because it could just open a whole world to people who were not very conscious of art also.
I think it's not so much to do with the gallery system, or because I don't think, you know, we have to, like, you know, especially talking about India, we need to, you know, create a lot of institutions to begin with, to be able to be outside of it. I think, you know, we are just learning. I mean, this is just the beginning, and we've just had, like, the galleries really come into life in last 15 years, I think. I mean, there were, like, a lot of galleries before that, but, you know, the way a certain system is set, I mean, we are still in the process of setting up that system. And I think, you know, we need to, you know, build institutions much before
we can move out of them.
Move out of them.
Yeah, I agree.
It doesn't make sense otherwise to be outside, and we've been outside of it. We need to move inside. You know, it's like
the other way around.
Yeah, it's in opposition to the way it is perhaps in a lot of other Western countries.
Yes.
A more developed system which is at place, that there is an opportunity to be outside and there's a need to be outside of it. I think it must come from a certain kind of definitive need, that as much as an artist making objects or moving in and out of the institutions, is something that we need to look at more carefully and with more responsibility.
And this is where probably more art education comes in. The need for more art education, which is completely lacking in schools at least.
Yes, I think. We have to redefine our the way we teach art in the art schools, and we have to redefine the way we teach anything,
Yeah.
I think, having been through a lot of research of, how art education itself is done, because I have a kid who's about to enter the school. So I think, there is a lot of effort that is being put in terms of education itself.
Right.
And art becomes a part of it in many ways.
Yes.
Or sports even.
True.
So I think, overall, especially with art education, I think we have to relook at the way we how the pedagogy, art pedagogy is built in terms of curriculum.
Right. And as an artist, how do you view the contemporary art scene in India and the changes it has gone through in the last one decade?
Mm-hmm.
In terms of both the audience as well as the artists, considering that, for the last 10 years you've been very closely associated.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the, is it a happy moment for the contemporary art scene in India?
Yeah, I think there is a lot of exciting younger artists who are experimenting in various ways and with various, not only material, with various ideas that are exciting. And I think there are many more artists at work than the time, I came out of an art school, which is a very, very positive, because there is a space that is available. I mean, there are there are residencies that are abroad, there are residencies within the country, which is, there are more galleries that show younger artists.
Right.
So I think, overall it's been going very well, I think, and it's in a process of going somewhere where our art becomes as good as anywhere else.
For you as an artist, is art more of a personal practice, or is it also that you also want to reach out to the larger audience and the viewers?
It's both. I think, how do you kind of differentiate the personal and the social in that sense?
Yes.
That everything is dictated by where I'm going to show, what I do. It's like right from, measuring the door size of a gallery. that all the objects have to enter it.
Enter it, yes.
Symbolically speaking. so I think, it's a... where was I?
The audience and the person.
Yeah, I think audience plays a huge role. And I think, everything everyone says about your work to, what you experience on an everyday basis is a part of your work.
Okay.
Has to become a part of your work.
Okay.
I think this reminds me, this interview that Manikal, our famous filmmaker, was giving about, speaking about his teacher's work, Prithvi Ghatak's work. He says there's a distinction to be made between drama and epic.
Okay.
So he talks about epic as something that kind of includes other worldviews,
right?
Other ways of looking. So I think, as an artist, it's my effort to kind of include all those worldviews, including this one in this case. Yeah. So I think, more and more worldviews, that it becomes eminently interpretative for each one to carry back with his own story about the work.
Right. Yeah. And that's why the narrative is a big part of your work.
Yes.
That's right. So what are you working on these days, Sudarshanji? Apart, of course, from the Biennale, the Guggenheim Museum Biennale. That is aside. But if you could talk a little about your own work.
I'm working on a couple of shows which are upcoming in 2017. I have a show in September in Vienna. So I'm working on, I mean, it's just the beginning that I'm like, you know, examining this idea of the idea of climbing, you know, what
climbing.
Does it mean?
Yeah. Okay, interesting.
And it includes the idea of architecture.
Yes.
It includes viver, or like looking at examining the idea of climbing, the verticality of things, and how does it connect to our own biological state, or biological, or a psychological, or a physiological state.
Right.
That how it can be kind of represented in a manner that is replicated, say, by a machine.
Okay.
Or so I'm looking at various ways of, you know, trying to explore that. I'm looking at the idea of robotics, I'm looking at architecture.
Okay.
And I'm looking at the notions of what climbing means. Mm. So it's a huge amorphous kind of space right now. So I'm sure it will, over the period of time, it will come together to be a show somewhere.
In a definite format.
Yeah.
Architecture keeps coming back in your idiom and vocabulary of work. Mm. Where does it, how does it figure and center in your works as far as, in terms of material, in terms of size, in terms of, in what way?
I think, you know, when I think of architecture, and I think, you know, its interface with your biological existence is something, or a physiological existence, is something that interests me enormously. And climbing is a part of that. Mm-hmm. The design of a staircase, or a design for an elevator.
Mm. Not the mountain.
Mountain, yeah, and I mean, talking about architecture, and you know, it's like man-made, and it kind of also represents on another level our own need to, you know, extend our own, like, you know, you have, like, probably this hall itself is in memory of someone.
Yes.
It also represents a stubbornness not to forget. So I think it's a need to kind of extend one's own biological existence to move beyond that. So it represents that, and also in itself it kind of, there is a vacuum within that, that it's futile in exercise in that sense. So, you know, both these positions are like, you know, simultaneously existent within the same space, as if they are not two different things for me. So how do you kind of represent that in a manner that it kind of includes, in a way that they are not seen as opposites, is something that I'm looking at.
Okay, for your next show.
Yeah.
So to talk a little about the Kochi Miseris Biennale, tell us that it has been coming together of various practices, where you opened the Biennale to theatre people, musicians, dancers, poets, and giving, not binding it in a form. It was multi-layered, if I were to use the word. So as a curator, when you first decided, what was in your mind when you thought of the Biennale?
Yeah,
as an artist also.
Yeah, sure. The first response when I was asked to be the curator was to kind of come up with the curatorial brief, curatorial statement that came from my own practice as an artist.
Exactly.
Only quickly to realize that, you know, it could be very limited, that it needed to be outside of those expectations or outside of those limitations. So the first thing was to kind of, you know, have conversations with people who are seemingly outside of the expectation of a Biennale space. So as you know, one of the first artists we declared is a poet, Raul Zurita. And instead of me coming up with a curatorial statement, you know, declaring my curatorial statement, we had him we invited him to come and read his poetry instead. Okay. So also looking at the role of a curator,
yes,
or an image of a curator who is supposed to be a creator of knowledge and culture. So the question was it possible to sidestep that and okay. see a curator as someone who is more of a host or a facilitator, so to say.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of, you know, curatorial theme could emerge from this process of, you know, these conversations okay. and kind of the direction that it would take in terms of, you know, looking at within the art world as well. So I think, you know, it's a very amorphous kind of, it became a very, very amorphous kind of, or a very, very organic kind of process, that also looking at these processes that began with my accepting the role through the time of the Biennale maybe. And for example, you know, I wrote, like, you know, the curatorial statement, the third curatorial statement that I wrote was, it kept changing, it kept evolving, and I'm on to a fifth curatorial statement wow. right now, which will appear in the catalog, and the third appeared during the declaration of curatorial statement. And what you see on the wall now in the Biennale space is my fourth curatorial statement, and I'm on to writing on my fifth. So I think, you know, I was interested in seeing it as a process of evolution, that kind of Biennale takes, can we see this, the question was also that, can we see this Biennale as something that is in the process of its own making?
Okay.
I think, yeah, it's been exciting, you know, so far. Mm. And a lot of the practices are in the making through the time of the Biennale, and some of them even will spill over literally after the time of the Biennale.
Right, so becoming like a work in progress.
Yes.
And it's also called the People's Biennale.
Yes.
Because you opened it up to people in terms of workshops, in terms of interactions, even involving children in workshops.
Yeah.
And making it was inclusive. Hmm. It just didn't put art on a pedestal, and you know, which could kind of.
I think Kochi Mudra's Biennale, right from its first edition, has been a people's Biennale to my mind. I mean, I think, you know, it makes it, the Biennale is very special to me because of the people's participation, really.
Right.
Like, even through the middle period of the Biennale, you'll see like busloads of people coming from, you know, all over the place and pouring over, you know, each and every piece of work, reading every text on the wall. So I think, you know, like, you know, you'll have rickshaw drivers outside. You have a conversation with them, and, you know, they have a favorite work in the Biennale.
Okay.
So I think,
it's not,
you know,
limited to,
it's not,
just a
yeah,
certain,
I think,
section,
you know,
of
kind
people.
Of it has a way, Kochi Mudra's Biennale has a way of embracing, you know, the locality, the place where it is located in already. I mean, which is what we took as a cue from, and we were like, you know, in my Biennale, in the Biennale that I curated, we were just taking on from those cues from what I had seen in the first two editions.
Right, right.
And to see if we can work upon that, you know, it's already a people's Biennale, and, you know, make it more accessible and more, I think it's already accessible. I mean, even the way the locations are, they're not your, you know, regular white cube spaces.
Right.
Like, even if you're looking at Aspinwall space, you know, you have a space which is like 10 by 10 room, 10 by 10 feet room, to, you know, you have like 5,000 square feet of a space with high ceiling. There are little spaces, there are large spaces, there are like various sizes of spaces, you know, in between those two. I think, yeah, so it's extremely kind of, the inside and the outside is very blurred.
Okay.
In that sense,
right.
It's not very well defined in that sense. In that sense, it makes it very, very welcoming. And and I think, you know, we were all only kind of, you know, working in a way that that we can take those cues and, you know, can we take it forward or, you know, elsewhere in various ways or
right.
in various directions.
In
various ways.
Right. The title of the Biennale was very fascinating, Forming in the Pupil of the Eye.
Yeah.
So tell us a little about it. It's very poetic, and I'm sure it also has a context.
Yeah, it's an interesting story that forming in the pupil of an eye came from, taken from a poetry that was written by my friend Sharmishta Mohanty, who incidentally is also part of the one of the artists in the Biennale. She has a beautiful work there, which in turn was taken from this idea, an ancient idea that when a sage opens his eye to the world, he assimilates all its multiplicity into that one vision. And eyes are the only reflective organ in the body. All our physiological, all our philosophical ideas come from our physical or physiological being. It's something that interested me a lot.
Yes.
So it's also referring to the fact that, you know, a lot of the ideas in the Biennale itself comes from the idea of making. And how do you make things? How do you disseminate things? And what does it mean to make things, you know? Does making only mean making of objects that are seemingly intended to be permanent?
Okay.
Or can you make objects that are ephemeral, that kind of flies off your fingers, you know, as you kind of look at it?
Right.
Is also the idea. I think, you know, in that sense, the title seemed perfect. I mean,
yes.
The line from our poetry was gathered in the pupil of an eye.
Okay.
To kind of imply more of a process based, or a kind of imply a certain kind of movement, we said forming in the pupil of an eye.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
So has the Biennale also been a learning process for you as a person, as an individual, as an artist?
Enormously, yeah. Enormously so. You know, I've learned so much that, I've seen so much that I feel enriched. Yeah, absolutely.
And also tell us a little about the different ways of selecting artists for the Biennale. What were the thoughts in your mind as an artist and as a curator when you reached out to these people? Was it a lot of research, a lot of going to studios and interactions and discussions? That must have been also great responsibility, like, to
It was a lot of it's a lot of hard work. I mean, it was like daunting in many ways, that it's like the scale of the Biennale is as such, and also that you know, you have to travel, you know. I had to be out on road for a long time, you know, away from home. But it's also enormously exciting. It was like a enormous learning that, you know, it's could be kind of counted as a lifetime of learning for me in some ways, that I have been, like I said, you know, in conversation with a lot of people that I wouldn't have had an access to otherwise. So I think in that sense it's been amazing for me as a from a personal point of view.
Right.
As well.
Right. The art that we see today has a lot of varied dimensions apart from just what was probably 25 years back, video, theater. It's all becoming, it's not being separated, it's become like coming together, like probably like Natya Shastra, which is, you know. So how do you see this coming together of various forms, ideas, dimensions, be it a video installation, be it installations with objects that you do. We have people combining poetry and painting to talk about what we experience, the world around us. How do you look at it with like somebody who experiments and internalizes art so much? Does it also sometimes go overboard as a fashion statement?
I think, you know, like I'm I get wary of these distinctions, you know, basically. I mean, whether one is a sculptor or one is a painter, you know, as much as I'm interested in, like, you know, the craft of making something, that craft in itself is, it's not a vacuum within itself, because craft can only come with an intense kind of engagement with something.
Right.
That engagement, in some ways or in many ways, must kind of bring out other philosophical aspects about making something.
Okay.
And I think this engagement is very important for me. And I think, you know, the making can be a means to knowledge production is something that interests me a lot.
Okay.
As well.
Right.
That it doesn't have to be all the time outside of the making.
Hmm.
That I think, you know, craft, for example, is seen in, like, you know, mostly in bad light.
That's right.
In the international, I mean, if it's, if something comes with a lot of craft, then it, you know, it's seen with a certain suspicion, you know, which I don't subscribe to.
Okay.
I think, you know, like even in the making of things, there is something that kind of is important, that, you know, it can produce knowledge. Yeah, I mean, it does produce knowledge.
Right.
As well.
Right. So do you teach also?
No? Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have an opportunity. <in that. laughs>
And any plans of writing something?
I would like to. Yeah, I mean, informally, I don't know how to teach. I'm a very bad teacher. You know, I've had the experience of trying to teach, but I think, you know, like, I need more. I need to equip myself more to be able to teach.
And what constantly drives and motivates you? Is it yourself or the world around you or what we see? Or what is, as an artist, what is that constantly inspires you? Like sometimes as writers, we have great writers' blocks. We just don't know what to say to the other person.
You don't know what, like, you know, how to approach something. You don't, I mean, it's like, you know, it's a process of, I think, living, that kind of, that in itself can be a challenge. So I think, you know, those things have to be looked at and examined, you know. I think, you know, like, one has to step outside of one's own skin constantly to be able to watch yourself, you know, where you're going while being inside of it.
Yeah.
I think, you know, both those positions are important to be kind of lived through,
right,
in many ways.
And how do you creative, that you strike a balance between commerce and art? Does it sometimes become a challenge as an artist? Not probably for you now, but earlier on in life, was it a challenge to subscribe to a certain...
No, we were like, you know, I mean, when I came out in art school, there was no gallery that... were willing to, I mean, it took me like 10 years to show after I came out of the school to do my first show. But that was never a consideration, you know. It was just kind of, we were making things and we were never, like, you know, we were making things nobody wanted to buy and nobody wanted to show. But I'm not talking only for myself.
No.
I mean, there are a lot of other people as well, a lot of other friends.
Yes.
We were hanging out together and
yes,
we were making and we were dreaming big and we were still, and somehow things got... became possible, and there were times it was not possible. So, I mean, a lot of people say that, you know, how did you survive those years?
Yes.
Or something. I thought, like, I mean, I think, you know, we had a great time because there were no expectations out of it. I think it's much more difficult now when you have a certain price on your head, you know, so to say.
Yes, so the earlier part was, you can choose not to answer this, but Western art, do you internalize more of when you say our own being, where we have come from? So does Western art take a back seat, or does the inspiration still come from there, or what is it that...
I think, you know, a lot of the ways I look at, like, for example, you know, if you're looking at your ancient art, I think, you know, a lot of the things, that a lot of the books that are written about your own, you know, art that comes from where you came from,
yes,
is written by Westerners.
Mm.
So I think it's important to learn, and, like, you know, it's to kind of gather, you know, whatever you can from the best you can from, you know, both the worlds, so to say.
Right.
If they were two different worlds, I don't think they are two different. I do not want to treat them as two different worlds, because, you know, a lot of what I've learned from the art school or kind of, you know, from the Western art is also a part of who I am today, so to say.
Right.
So I think, you know, I don't want to differentiate, and you know, it's not a kind of position of resistance or reaction even to where I come from. I don't see them in binaries in that sense. But however, having said that, I think it's important to look back from where you came from, whatever that means, constantly, and keep a watch on that. I think there cannot be a way of looking forward unless you constantly are looking backwards as well. Back as well, not backwards. Yeah.
And you constantly do that in your own.
I try to do that.
Yes. In your own practice.
Yeah, yeah.
And any piece of work or any dream that always plays on your mind, which you foresee in the future? There's something that you have to create or want to create?
I'll get on to it straight away as soon as I get an idea and see where it goes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there is a constant thinking when you are.
I think one thing leads to another, you know, like, I mean, it's not like, like I said earlier, I mean, I don't see one show or one work as a postulation, you know, I just see it as a part of a larger process.
So it's an extension of what you have already done.
Yeah, yeah.
And how have you changed over the years as an artist? When you look back, now we are looking back, what are the dramatic changes that you feel has taken place in your art as well as your own personality with
I think, you know, one of the things is, like, I remember when we were students, we were like, you know, constantly seeking information that there was so little available to us. You know, we were waiting for magazines that were published abroad would come, and you know, we would pore over it to just to be able to kind of get a little of, you know, whatever that was happening, to be able to be abreast for various reasons, right? So I think it's completely the reverse now in many ways.
Okay.
Completely the opposite, that, you know, there's so much information that it really becomes about erasure. And one of the things is, can you can include those erasures into what you choose? As soon as you choose something, it kind of represents that enormous amount of erasure that you need to do. So I think your work, I mean, as an artist, I feel that my work is about that erasure constantly, more than the choices you make.
Okay, so the elements keep, right. Thank you, Sudarshan. It was great to speak to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.